Welcome to another screencast on writing in plain legal English. Have you ever had someone tell you that your document needs more structure or your essay needs more structure and been frustrated by that and not known what they mean? Well, that's what we're going to be talking about today. We're going to be talking about a technique that I call signposting. But let's start with a common problem. A common example of what I mean is when you stop and ask yourself, wait, why is the author discussing this? How did we get here? You've literally become lost. You don't know where you've come from and where you're going to with the document. My point is that your reader should never be lost. If they are, you've done something wrong. The easiest way to get around this is to provide signposts along the way. We can also call this bridging, we can call it milestones, we can call it roadmaps. But the essential idea is from time to time, you should tell your reader how you've got to where you are and where you're going next. So today's guiding principle that we're discussing is signposting. And to signpost, you need a plan. You need a sense of where you're going. This is the essence of structuring a document. And the easiest way to structure any document or argument or essay is to take the advice that's given to all public speakers. Tell them what you're going to tell them. Tell them, then tell them what you've told them. Put in essay writing terms, you need an introduction, you need a body, you need a conclusion. Tell them what you're going to tell them. Tell them. Tell them what you've told them. And your introduction can be made quite powerful by the idea we talked about last time, sequencing. This legal issue has three problems. First, second, third. That completes your introduction. Then you outline problems 1, 2, and 3 in separate paragraphs in your body. Then you sum up. Bang, there you have it. Basic essay. Before we go to new ideas about signposting, though, I want to highlight how ideas we've already discussed in previous screencasts can help you with signposting. So we've already discussed the importance of a good, clear introduction. A good, clear introduction will set your reader up so they understand where the rest of your document is going. Topic sentences, a nice, clear sentence that introduces each paragraph and explains where that paragraph is going will also keep your reader on track. And also we've done an exercise on bridging between paragraphs. Techniques for linking paragraphs together. And we did that by examining topic sentences from a number of pieces of writing. Today, what I want to talk about is the use of headings. And headings, in effect, divide your document into sections. So each of those sections will begin and conclude. But if you look at a document with a heading in it, there will be a section ending above the heading and a new section beginning below the heading. And I want to talk about how you bridge around the heading, how you get it to flow so that the reader understands why this section is finishing and what it's achieved, that the heading signals where they're going, and then the new section beginning helps them understand how they've come there and why they're moving in this direction. And the techniques we're going to be talking about will include explicit signposts, reminders, i.e. summaries of the section and how you've got to this point, or milestones, which is basically the same thing, saying, look, we've come this far, we have this far to go. I'll give some practical examples of what I mean. Once again, I'm going to draw some examples from my own writing, and I'm sorry if this comes off as boastful. It's just easy examples that I have lying around, and they don't really generate copyright problems. But anyway, so I recently wrote a paper called Responsibility for Collective Atrocities. What I have here in these bullet points are the headings that I used in about the first two-thirds of that paper. So, first heading, introduction connecting distant leaders with collective atrocities. Now, you don't need to know about the field I was writing on, which was international criminal law, to get a sense of what's going on here. The paper is going to deal with a basic problem, which is connecting leaders with crimes committed by their followers far away from them, physically and structurally. So we can understand that that might be a tricky thing to prove. Second heading, the legacy of Nuremberg. If you know anything about international criminal law, you'll have heard of the Nuremberg trials at the end of the Second World War. So you'll understand that this heading probably introduces a historic section. Next heading, the commission of a crime and the distinction between principles and accessories. Okay, so you'll see that I'm going from history to basic concepts in criminal law, basic criminal legal theory. Then, probably, quite a poor heading on reflection. Joint criminal enterprise and co-perpetration in international criminal law, their alternatives, and the importance of fair labelling. If a student presented me with that heading, I probably wouldn't be terribly impressed. It's got perhaps too much information in it. But for our exercise, we can still see that, you know, it will tell us what's coming in that section. I'll be discussing two criminal law theories, joint criminal enterprise and co-perpetration. I'll also be discussing their alternatives. And you get the sense that this other criminal law concept called fair labelling is important in choosing between these theories and their alternatives. So not a great heading, but it works well enough. Then, again, in my opinion and on reflection, a much better heading, applying the divergent theories to a scenario. Now, you know exactly what's going to come in that section, don't you? There's going to be a hypothetical. I'm going to say, well, here's theory A, here's theory B. Does it make any difference in a practical case which one we apply? So nice, clear heading there. Okay, so just reading those headings, you've hopefully got a reasonably clear idea of how my paper begins, what problem it's concerned with, where it's going, and the technique it's going to use to address it. The touchstone's going to be this hypothetical scenario. Now, on the way through a document, any piece of legal writing, look for explicit signposting. Look for what I call roadmap sentences. Sentences that tell you expressly where the paper is going and how it's going to get there. And some of them might be very crude and obvious, like this one of mine. The remainder of this paper will examine both joint criminal enterprise and international criminal court co-perpetration in slightly more detail before applying each to a hypothetical scenario and then offering some concluding observations. So really, I am signposting the next three steps in the paper, or even four. I'm going to discuss theory A, theory B, apply both of them to a scenario, and then conclude. Very, very crude, obvious roadmap sentence. There are some other, though, examples of roadmap-type sentences that one might use. These could also be thought of as section endings or milestones, putting down a marker and saying, hey, we've got to this point. And sentences like that might look something like the examples I have here. They might start with a phrase like, the argument to this point has been, so you're summing up. Having reached conclusion X, it is now necessary to discuss Y. So you're reminding the reader, okay, I've run this long argument, here I am, but that leads to a next logical point. Or when you're doing things the other way, when you've spent a part of a paper clearing away an argument, explaining why something is not necessary, then you might have a sentence that begins with something like, in summary, there is no convincing argument that. Now, these all have elements of bridging techniques that we've discussed in previous screencasts. Okay. Now let's come to this idea I have of section endings. You need to set things up before your next heading to signpost where you've come from and where you're going. Well, you don't have to, but it might often be a good idea if you do. So here's again something from my collective responsibility paper. While we can describe a person's relationship to a crime in several ways, so clearly there's been some sort of discussion about that already. The first and most obvious distinction is that between principles and accessories. So I'm setting up a distinction. This paper will now turn to that distinction, express signposting, but the concept of fair labelling is returned to later. Again, express signposting and possibly summing up, because perhaps I've already mentioned fair labelling. Well, you'd expect I have given that sentence. Under the heading, describing the culpability of leaders for mass atrocities, really explicit signposting. So at the end of a section, I've both summed up some of the things I've been talking about and provided very direct pointers about where I'm going in later sections. Okay, let's come to this idea of mine of bridging around headings. So headings can help guide the reader, but so can the text either side. Now, the next example is a little dense, and I'm sorry for that, but it's important to try and get a section ending, a heading, and a section beginning on the same screen. So hopefully this will prove useful. So this comes at the end of the hypothetical that was going to be the centerpiece of my paper. In the hypothetical, we do not need to brand any of the leaders' principles to describe their conduct as criminal. So I'm summing up. This is the thing I hope to have proved through my applying the law to my hypothetical scenario. So why should we? Now, this is potentially a dangerous technique. If you ask a rhetorical question, if you end a sentence with a question mark, it can be a useful signpost, but you absolutely must answer that question. Otherwise, it looks like weak writing, and it looks like you're trying to cover up a point by asking a question about it, but then moving on. So the classic undergraduate mistake is to ask questions like, who can say what's really right or wrong in this situation? Well, you can. It's what your teachers will expect you to do. But it can also be a mistake more experienced writers make. So I have to be careful to answer that question. This raises once again the question why international courts feel impelled to describe as principles at least some of these remote or indirect offenders. So I've actually said, look, I am going to answer this. I have drawn attention to this question. Here's the issue. Why we describe these guys as principals, not as accessories. Don't worry, I'm coming to it. And then look, my next heading, describing the culpability of leaders for mass atrocities. Principals, mere accessories, or aggregators of responsibility. So I've laid out the three options that arise from my question. Then I've asked at the end of the previous section, why do courts feel impelled to describe these guys as principals? And there's at least the beginning of an answer in my new section opening, though if you think about it, it's not a complete answer. I would suggest that our moral impulse is to hold leaders responsible for consequences they have caused, rather than merely for wrongs they have physically carried out. Outcome responsibility in Honoré's term. So I'm clearly going to go on and discuss whether that should lead to labelling someone as being a principal or an accessory. But you can see that I've set up a question, and then each of my sort of conclusion to that section, the heading, and the beginning of the next section begins to outline how I'm going to answer it. Okay, so let's sum up on signposting. In previous screencasts, we've talked about techniques that could help in signposting. Good clear introductions, topic sentences, and bridging. Today we've talked about other more explicit signposting techniques, including using headings, roadmap and summing up or milestone sentences that point the reader to where you're going or remind them how you've got to this point, and then also the technique of looking at your section endings. Look at how your paragraphs end, not just how they begin, and how you might make your sections flow around a heading. Make that section ending, heading, and new section opening reinforce the idea that your argument is moving logically. Well, that concludes everything I wanted to say today about signposting. I hope it's been useful. Thank you for tuning into this screencast, and I very much hope you'll tune into the next one.